Chag Sameach. I wanted to talk to you about a very significant and very unusual law that is related to the mitzvah of sukkah. So the basic commandment of the sukkah is not only to put it up, right, but to actually live in it. The term is teshuvu, basukot teshuvu. You should live in the sukkah for 7 days. And we say teshuvu ke'ein taduru. You should be dwelling in the sukkah the way that you would reside in your house. So you're supposed to decorate the sukkah with nice decorations. You're supposed to bring your better furniture and your better dishes into the sukkah, and you're supposed to spend as much time as possible in the sukkah like it was your house. But then there's a very interesting exemption to this general requirement to be spending as much time as possible in the sukkah, and that is if being in the sukkah is extremely uncomfortable for you. So if your sukkah is in an area of the world where it's too cold to sit comfortably in the sukkah, you would be exempt. If you were in a part of the world where it's very hot and very humid and your sukkah would be full of mosquitoes and they would be biting you all the time and you wouldn't be able to do anything about it, then you would be exempt. Okay, so the principle is that a mitzta'er, someone who is suffering, someone who is uncomfortable, is exempt from the sukkah. And the Tosfot say, yes, this is an expression of teshuvu ke'ein taduru, that you should live in the sukkah the way that you would reside in your house. Nobody's going to live in their house if it's infested with mosquitoes, if there's flooding, right, up to their ankles. They're going to take their stuff and they're going to leave and they're going to go somewhere else. So similarly, if you're in an experience of the sukkah where you are mitzta'er, where you feel really uncomfortable, where it's just extremely unpleasant, then it would be ludicrous, right, to stay in the sukkah, because you would never stay in your house under these circumstances. I'd like to suggest that it's also possible that the reason why it's specific, right, on Sukkot, that a person who is mitzta'er, a person who is suffering or uncomfortable, is exempt, has to do with the nature of Sukkot. What is Sukkot? It's Zaman Simchatenu. It's the time of our happiness. And if you go into the sukkah and you are dripping with misery, that experience is entirely inconsistent with what sitting in the sukkah is supposed to be. Sitting in the sukkah is supposed to be an expression of the fact that now is the time that we're happy. If you're sitting in the sukkah and you're miserable, right, then it's counterproductive. It goes against the grain of what the holiday is supposed to accomplish. Now, unfortunately, Pesach is not Zman Simchatenu. Pesach is not the time of our joy. Pesach is the time of our freedom. And sometimes with great freedom comes great responsibility. So if you don't like eating matzah, you have to eat matzah. And if drinking a lot of wine makes you uncomfortable, unless it makes you very sick, you have to drink a lot of wine. Right, so on Pesach, in contrast, there isn't this notion that being uncomfortable is in some ways in tension with what the holiday is trying to accomplish. And therefore, if you are mitzta'er on Pesach, as the rabbis say, too bad. Okay, you would still be obligated to eat matzah and do all of the things that we do on Pesach, even if it was uncomfortable for you. And this, I think, is the proper way to understand the verse, V'samachta b'chagecha, v'hayita ach sameach. You should rejoice, celebrate in your festival, in your holiday, and v'hayita ach sameach, and you will also be happy. Right? It seems to be both a promise and a commandment. Right, and I think that one of the ways that we express the truth of this verse is that on Sukkot, we are supposed to be experiencing the holiday in a way that makes us happy. So that the simcha, the joy that we experience on Sukkot, is not manufactured. It's not artificial. It's actually supposed to be an expression of our tapping into and really becoming sensitive to the ways that we can serve God with true deep and unmitigated joy. And I think that actually this brings us back to, right, the notion of teshvu kein tadu, that you should live in the sukkah the way that you live in your home, that there's something about Sukkot that's supposed to be natural. Okay, you're supposed to live in the sukkah the way that you live in your house. And also the joy that you experience on Sukkot is supposed to be a natural joy. And I would say similarly, right, we could sort of go in the opposite direction. Just as we learn from how you live in your house to how you should dwell in your sukkah, also we can learn from how you dwell in your sukkah to how you should live in your house. By which I mean, Sukkot is supposed to be paradigmatic of how we should feel all year round, right? That our service of God should be as natural as possible, and more importantly, as joyful as possible. Now for me, this is actually quite easy because Sukkot is my favorite holiday and I'm excited already for it to come. And it's always been, right, a real source of joy for me. And I have this very strong memory of once when I was packing up to go into the sukkah, I had my, you know, sleeping bag in one hand and my pillow in the other hand, and I had one of these headlamps, and I was really all ready to go to read a little and then to sleep in the sukkah. And it was, you know, probably around 50 degrees out. And my sister asked, I think, a very reasonable question. And she just said, do you like to sleep in the sukkah because you like to go camping? Or do you like to go camping because it's like sleeping in the sukkah, right? So which is the thing that I really love? Is it getting an opportunity to sleep outside and wake up with the dew on my sleeping bag and on my face? Or is it that I really love to sleep in the sukkah and feel like I'm with the Shekhinah and get to feel like I'm in the clouds of glory, and therefore I try to recreate that experience any other time I can by going to, you know, spend more time in nature? And I said to my sister, really, it's both, right? That my love for camping supports and illuminates my love for the sukkah. For me, sleeping in the sukkah, spending more time in the sukkah, is a natural expression of something that I already want to do. But because it's a mitzvah, it brings me even greater joy, because not only am I doing what I want to do, I'm able to do what God wants me to do in the same action, right? There's a beautiful syncing up of who I am, what I naturally feel like doing and who I naturally want to be, and what the Torah is asking of me and what the Torah is demanding. And so for me, the mitzvot of Sukkot in general, right, are an expression of what I like to call righteous pleasures. Okay, so we all know about guilty pleasures. Guilty pleasures are the things that we do that give us joy and enjoyment, but that joy and enjoyment is tinged by a sense of, but I really shouldn't be doing this, and maybe even I don't want to tell anybody that I've done this. Okay, so a lot of us have foods that we really like to eat, but know that they're not healthy, and therefore when we're in public, right, we'll eat a kind of socially acceptable amount, and then when we're in private, we'll eat much more, and that is a guilty pleasure, right? You don't feel great about the fact that you had this enjoyment, because this enjoyment is tied into there being negative consequences and there being a narrative in your own head and in the perception of others that the joy that you are having is not really a good joy. There's a TV show that you really like to watch, but you know that it's trashy and you know that it's kind of rotting your brain from the inside out, and you watch it. But every time you finish watching, you know, an hour or 2 hours or God forbid more of some garbage television show, afterwards you feel a little disgusting, right? You feel a little bad about the joy that you had. And righteous pleasures are exactly the opposite, right? When you are experiencing a righteous pleasure, when you're channeling your loves and your wants and your desires and your personality into doing something that God wants you to do or that you want you to do, right? Then there's no aftertaste, right? There's no badness. There's no admixture to the joy. You just feel happy, right? That you've been able to both do something that you enjoy and at the same time serve God and serve your higher self at the same time. So to give an example, there are plenty of people who love to cook, right? And at some point, cooking too much or using too fancy of an ingredient could be a little excessive. And if you're only cooking for yourself, so then it could veer into the realm of guilty pleasure. But what if you're cooking for Shabbat? What if you're cooking a special meal for a friend who just gave birth, or God forbid, a friend who just lost a family member? Then your love of cooking, right, which is a natural love of cooking, you would do it anyway, is now elevated because you're doing it in the service of your friend. You're doing it in the service of a mitzvah. And that is what I think the lesson is of Sukkot, right? That the ideal of how we want to navigate the world is by focusing our energies into channeling the mitzvot and the good deeds and the way that we want to be in the world that is consistent with who we naturally are, right? So that we're able to serve God with a joy that is joyous. This doesn't mean, right, that we're off the hook from doing the things that we don't want to do. But what it does mean is that the ideal of what it means to serve God, right, as seen, right, through the lens of the experience of Sukkot, is that we try to have a joyous attitude towards God. And the way that we do that is by focusing on and channeling the things in our lives and the things in our personalities that naturally work for us and that naturally give us joy. So with that, I'd like to wish you a Chag Sameach Sameach, a joyous holiday that is guided by and full of true natural joy.